Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, whoever seeks to please the people under the cost of displeasing Allah, what will happen? Two things. Number one, Allah will be displeased by you, and that's enough of a disaster. But then the Prophet adds to that and he says, Allah will be displeased by you. In addition, the people you tried to please will be displeased by you. Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. We begin by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for when Allah's name is mentioned into something, we believe there's barakah placed into it. So may Allah continuously allow us to think of Him and be reminded of Him. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, and may Allah send His peace and blessings upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Amma ba'd. I'd like to thank you all for your attendance. Jazakumullahu khairan. Jumping into the session about people's judgment. Now, I was asking and wondering, why don't you guys clap? So the question is that, is that a cultural thing or not? And is it right for me to consider, just an example, that the people that do not clap are rude, and therefore you are not enjoying the content? You see where I'm coming from? Because in some cultures, not doing that is disrespectful. And as a Muslim, you should not come to conclusions. And it's something to always appreciate. I was, in one weekend, I was on Saturday in a conference in the US. Every time I was clapping. The second day, I went to another conference. They don't clap. So it was very awkward. Was it boring? The way they clap is like, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It was like, you know how we clap really hard, like, And that's how they're clapping. We respect that. So when it comes to taking care of people's judgment, it's not always a bad thing. As long as you do not forsake Allah's judgment, it's not under the cost of displeasing Allah. Is it clear? Who here believes wearing a kufi is a religious thing, sunnah? Who believes that? Raise your hand. Who believes it's a natural act, not ritual? It was a cultural thing. Raise your hand. Really? I thought Malaysians are really big about kufis. Really? So personally, we have to respect both opinions. Can we do that for the rest of our lives? Because it's valid, correct? Some people believe it's cultural. That's what the Prophet ﷺ did with the Sahaba, because that's a traditional. And some believe it's actually the sunnah to do that. But the bottom line, what's the wajib is to respect both. Is it clear? So I'm caring about your judgment. And I asked, inshallah, next week I have a khutbah, Friday khutbah. So I asked the organizers, would you prefer me wearing a thobe and a kufi? And they said, yes, please do. Even though I believe this is not a wajib, but I will wear it because I care about your judgment. But I'm not caring about your judgment in a way that I want to please you and not please Allah. Rather, I want to please you to please Allah. Because if this is going to unite us, then I'll go for it. Why not? And it's something that we always should keep note of. When you unite over something that is possible, wallahi, do whatever it takes. You know, one of the great examples of the Sahaba when they went for Hajj. The Khalifa, for example, would not shorten the prayer, as an example. And then one of the Sahaba who believes you should shorten the prayer, but I will go with that imam so we are united and not disunited. Allahu Akbar. May Allah make us basically practice our deen the way Allah wants us to practice it. Say Ameen. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. Unity is very critical. But the moment you go into a scenario where seeking people's pleasure will be under the cost of displeasing Allah, then that when things become difficult. So let's go through some examples of scenarios of how you will deal with it. Are you guys ready, inshallah? Let's talk about backbiting, ghiba. What's ghiba? Anybody knows what's ghiba? What's backbiting? Bismillah. Backbiting, go ahead. Go ahead. Excellent, excellent. So he says saying something about the people behind their backs. But there's one word you have to add to this. One word. Saying something behind the people's back which they do not like. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the following, dhikruka akhaka bima yakrah, mentioning something about your brother or sister in a way they do not like. So that's a criteria that you have to have. Now, you're sitting in a gathering. It's very frequent, especially nowadays, that backbiting is very light and easy. Backbiting is like the dessert of every gathering. And it gets boring if we don't talk about other people who are not present. As a believer, the one who seeks Allah's judgment, if you're sitting down and someone talks bad about your brother, you have to do something about it. You cannot say, I don't want to tell them, please not talk about it. I want to move away. No, because I fear my friends will make fun of me. I'm a boring person. They will never befriend me. A'udhu billah. At this point, you seek Allah over them. Is it clear? Now, how do you do that? You need some motivation. You guys drink Red Bull? Okay. Now, we have some our Red Bulls, which is knowing the reward of things and knowing the punishment of things. And that's how we both are influenced. So for example, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wallahi, it's enough of a benefit. If you say 10, 15 times in this lecture, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's enough of a benefit. You guys agree? So continuously say it whenever you hear that beautiful name. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that the one who you backbit in dunya, this is Hasan hadith, will be brought to you yawm al-qiyamah. And Allah will be telling that person, kulhu mayyita kama akaltahu hayya, eat them dead just like how he ate them when they were alive. In yawm al-qiyamah, will we have an option to say, no, I won't, I will not? Do we have an option? No. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the body will be right in front of you. فَيَأْكُلْهُ وَيَكْلَحْ وَيَصِيحْ. You will be forced to literally eat that body. وَيَكْلَحْ وَتَ الْكُلُوحْ. When the upper lip reaches the middle of the head and the lower lip reaches the middle of the chest, and you will literally be like an anaconda swallowing that body. That's an example of the punishment. Allah mentioned in the Quran, Surah Al-Hujarat, أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا. Isn't that right? Would you love for you to eat the flesh of your brother? Allah responds, فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. You will not like it. Allah knows. People will be discussing, is this halal meat or is this haram meat, right? Is this dabiha? So they go to McDonald's, they're like, Akhi, this halal sign is fake, I'm telling you, right? It's fake. Akhi, no, no, I'm telling you it's halal. Back and forth, no, I will order fish, I will order chicken. Okay, whatever, you order what you want, you order what you want. Then we go on the dinner table. You know what happens? They eat human beings' flesh with no difference of opinion by talking ill about other people. But at this point, what should you do? The one who, don't worry about their judgment at this point. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in authentic narration, مَنْ ذَبَّ عَنْ عِرْضِ أَخِيهِ. Wallahi, this is remarkable. Whoever defends the honor of their brother or sister. Someone tells you, brother so-and-so is stingy. You're like, no, he is generous. Such behavior. You know what's a reward when you defend your brother? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَعْتَقَهُ اللَّهُ مِنَ النَّارِ. This is one of the greatest rewards you will ever be blessed with in your life. What does that mean, a'taqahu Allah? That means their neck is unleashed from hellfire, even before Islam came. And you have to understand that term because it's mentioned in many other ahadith. For example, in Ramadan, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لِلَّهِ عُتَقَاءٌ مِنَ النَّارُ وَذَلِكَ كُلَّ لَيْلَةٍ. Brother, translate, I will. The Prophet says, every night Allah has utaqa from hellfire, and he chooses them every night. May Allah free our necks from hellfire. Say Ameen. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. You know what does that mean? Back in Jahiliyyah, when they free a slave, can the master ever say, no, come back, you're a slave again? Can they do that? Can they retract their statement? Impossible. So now, go to what Allah and the Prophet said. When Allah unleashes your neck for that one incident, that means you will never enter hellfire. Someone will say, but what if I was a kafir after that, right? Allah will adjust your life in a way that you won't die in such state because of a sincere moment where you defended your brother and sister. These are moments, if you care about Allah's judgment, look how honorable you will be in Allah's sight. May Allah make us strong. Say Ameen. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. But you have to be very wise. I know when it comes to parents, it's very difficult. You know, your mom tells you, your brother is driving me crazy. Your brother, you're like, mama, that's ghiba. Ittaqillah. No, don't do that with your mother, okay? Because now you might be doing a bigger sin than what other sin. May Allah protect us. Say Ameen. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. So it's something to truly appreciate. One time I was driving, and there was a brother. He's like, do you know what brother so-and-so did? I'm like, whoa. I'm like, don't continue, akhi. He's like, bro, but it's a fact. I'm like, it doesn't matter if it's a fact. It does not change the law. Because the Prophet says, ذِكْرُكَ أَخَاكَ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ, mentioning your brother in a way they do not like, correct? The Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, what if what we're saying is true? That guy is stingy. That guy is a coward. He says, that's ghiba. And if what you say is not true, then that's extreme oppression. So it doesn't make any difference. Some will say, well, I will say it in his face. It doesn't make any difference. It's still backbiting. So I told the brother, please don't continue. He's like, Akhi, but I saw him with that other person. I'm like, Akhi, please stop. And then the thing is that the other guy is difficult to praise. You know what I'm saying? I cannot say, well, no, he's a modest man, because generally what we see is not the best, but still that does not allow you to talk ill about him. He continues. I'm like, Wallahi al-Azim, if you continue, Wallahi, I will stop in the middle of the road and drop you. He's like, ah, whatever, you're not going to do it. I'm like, if you continue, I'm going to drop you in the middle of the street. He's like, okay, whatever. You know what the brother did? I'm like, ah, stop and get out. He's like, are you serious? I'm like, dead serious. You leave the car. He's like, bro, are you seriously going to do this? I'm like, yes, I'm seriously going to do this. He's like, okay, sure. May Allah make us always strong. Because maybe one day I pass, the other day I fail. But I'm not going to mention a day I failed to you guys, right? I'm going to mention the good stuff. So the point being, he opened the door, left the car, and I looked him in the mirror, and then I just drove off. And he's looking small and small and small in the mirror, and he's gone. But after that, he never opened up a topic like that. May Allah give us the reward of doing that. Ameer Rabbil Alameen. Well, it's just something that we can appreciate. When you have people's judgment, he might not like me anymore. He might judge me as like, oh, you're a boring person, you're extreme, you're so paranoid, you're so picky. Mention whatever you want to mention. But there's something to truly appreciate. Comes to fatwa, for example. We went back, but let's talk a little about fatwa. Giving a fatwa, one time I traveled to a faraway city. After the event, as a keynote speaker, a sister puts me aside, or a brother, regardless of the gender or what the question really is. They asked me a question, and I told them, I do not know. Then they're like, what do you mean you do not know? I'm like, I really do not know the answer to your question, even though your question is beautiful. Then they told me, we brought you all the way from this place to travel all the way here so you can tell me you do not know? Like, are you serious? I'm like, you know, I could have given you an answer, but it might have been wrong. So I destroy your life and I destroy my afterlife. What's the point of that? Her judgment might have been severe on me, that I will never be invited by them. Isn't that right? But this, when Allah comes in, do you care about Allah's judgment, yes or no? And don't ever be shy. And you will never go wrong when you say, I do not know. Or when you say, Allahu A'lam. What does Allahu A'lam mean? What does it mean? Allah knows best. You can use it for any question in the world. Any question. Ask, brother, are you a Muslim? Allahu A'lam. Isn't it? Allah knows best. Brother, are you straight? Allahu A'lam. A'udhu billah. What are you talking about, brother? Allah knows best. You never go wrong with it. And even brings you a smile, alhamdulillah, and saves your life. Allahu A'lam. By the way, the answer is yes for both. Okay? Just joking. Yeah. Allahu A'lam. But the point being is something to truly appreciate. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wallahi, this hadith is remarkable. This hadith humbles every creature who says, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. May Allah make you die upon it. La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. A man asked the Prophet in an authentic narration, what are the most disliked locations in the sight of Allah? Is it clear? What is the most disliked location in the sight of Allah? When the Prophet was asked this question, what did the Prophet say? La adri, I do not know. If the Prophet was able to say la adri, then what about us? Did he care about people judging him? Well, you're not worthy of being a prophet. La, move on. So he said, let me go ask Jibreel. So he goes, asks Jibreel. Jibreel, ma ashrul aswaqi aw al-buldani ila Allah. What is the most disliked location in the sight of Allah? You know what Jibreel alayhi salam, obviously would give the answer, right? He is the angel that was assigned to every prophet. But Jibreel said, La adri, I do not know. Hatta as'ala Rabbi, until I go ask Allah. So Jibreel goes, asks Allah, and gets the response for Allah is Al-Alim, the All-Knowing. Jibreel goes back, he says, Ya Muhammad, laqad sa'altani, you asked me, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is the most disliked location in sight of Allah? Fasa'altu Rabbi, I asked Allah, and he told me the answer. But you see how they went through it? He didn't say, oh, you know what, I believe, I do not know, but I think, but I think. You do not know, khalas, save your life, save your deen. People will judge you. People will judge you severely. I'll be very honest with you. People on the in the online world are very harsh. Very harsh. But when they are in your in front of your face, they will never say what they said about you online. Like, I got called kafir. I was called even munafiq for coming to this conference. I don't know why. Like, I'm wearing a suit. Like, look how cool I am. Allahu Akbar, subhanAllah. And if I'm wearing any, Allahu Akbar, you cannot be saved from people's tongues. You wear a suit, you please a group of people. Others are like, this is, you know, mubtadi', this is extreme, this guy. I wear a thobe, Allahu Akbar, you are upon the haqq. And the other ones are like, you're upon the bid'ah. You cannot please people, it's impossible. That's something for you to appreciate. Only seek Allah's judgment at the end of the day. Wallahi, you will never be able to please the people, no matter what you say. And inshallah, we'll go more towards it. This is an example of a man called Juha. It's like people, they use him as an example. So he was traveling with his son. So when they were traveling with his son, he was riding on the donkey, and his son, being the young man, was walking by him. He passed by a village. So the people of the village said, look at this father who has no mercy towards his son. His son is walking while the father is sitting on the donkey. Then the father was affected by that, by people's judgment. He stepped off the donkey. He let his son ride, and now the father is walking. They passed by the second village. They say, look at this disobedient son. He is sitting on the donkey while the father who raised him and took care of him is walking. A'udhu billah from such son. May Allah protect us and grant us one like him. So the father was like, get out, get down, get down, get down. So then the father and the son were sitting on the donkey. They passed by the third village. Like, what is wrong with these people who have no mercy towards animals? This deen gives animals rights. And two sitting on one donkey, A'udhu billah. So then what happened? The father told the son, let's both walk. So then the son is walking, and the father is walking, and there's no one riding on the donkey. So they pass by the fourth village. They say, what idiots. They have a donkey, and they're traveling. No one is sitting on it. You will never be able to please people. Always have this in mind. That's generally speaking, but pay attention. One of my teachers said something remarkable. He says, إرضاء الناس غاية لا تدرك. Pleasing the people is impossible. ولا تترك. And you should not overlook it. Even though it's impossible, but you should not completely overlook it. You try your best to unite people as long as you don't forsake Allah's judgment. Is that clear? That's something to truly appreciate. Now moving forward about you doing a good deed. How many times people are worried, if I do this deed, then people will judge me. Oh, now you think you're so holy, right? Now, some of you may be attending, and then maybe your past was not the best, for example. After the event, you're like, oh, so now you're all holy, you're all religious now, huh? Then you're like, you know what, I will no longer do a good deed, khas, move on, I don't want to hear this stuff. People have this against them when they want to give nasiha, they want to give advice. I want to give advice to you. Then they tell you, you advised me, remember 3 years ago in South Malaysia when we went to the beach, remember? And now you're going to give me nasiha about praying Fajr on time? You used to make qiyam on drinking, now you make qiyam on salah? They're like, you know what? I don't want that kind of talk. Forget people. I don't want to face that, such people's judgment and leave it. La, our religion was based on nasiha. You don't ever overlook it. But you have to be gentle and smart and wise at how to approach it. That's the key. That's the key. But never, the Prophet said, ad-deenun nasiha. This whole religion is based upon positive influencing advice. This ummah was the best ummah. Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin-nas. Why? Why were we the best nation? تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You tell people what's good, you tell them what is bad. وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. The moment you leave the أمر بالمعروف نهي عن المنكر, we're not the best nation anymore. So you have to be very critical towards it. Look how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was not really worried to advise a sahaba, they might think bad about me. No. One time Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he's a big guy, right? Big guy, mashallah, tabarakallah. His biceps may be bigger than my head. And my head over in this screen, mashallah, is really big. I noticed, by the way. I can see my head movement from here. Subhanallah. Imagine. May Allah protect you. Forgive me for taking over the screen. Okay? And for my picture on the program, some people are like, A'udhu billah, I look like a vampire. Forgive me. I look better than this. I'm like, you know why you're laughing? Because you thought of this already. A'udhu billah. Astaghfirullah. May Allah forgive you. Who is backbiting about your brother? May Allah forgive you. Did you zoom in when I did this? I hope you didn't. Anyways, the point being, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam seeing Umar al-Khattab coming to kiss the black stone, and if you ever saw on television how much of chaos takes place around the black stone, correct? I went to Hajj in 2008. I've seen it with my own eyes. People competing to kiss the black stone. It's a disaster. It's a disaster. And one sister, mashallah, tabarakallah, bro, she was like moving away. The brothers, like, move away here. And she was going to kiss the black stone. And she's like a soldier. Then, a'udhu billah. It might sound funny, but it's so, also sad. But one brother, what he did, because she was so strong and she went across him, he went and took off her hijab. Then she was panicking and she moved forward. She didn't, just to kiss the black stone. But that issue of being having a lot of chaos, subhanAllah, during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and kissing the black stone is a sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ. Umar al-Khattab said, while he was kissing the black stone, I know you do not benefit nor do you harm, but I'm following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. In another hadith, Rasulullah ﷺ says, the black stone will come yawm al-qiyamah and will have a tongue and will speak about those and testify and be like a witness for you that you kissed the black stone. And may Allah allow us to kiss the black stone, Amir Rabbil Alameen, while not ruining our deen. Amir Rabbil Alameen. So the point being, Umar Khattab radiallahu anhu goes to kiss the black stone. So the Prophet saw a scene where Umar radiallahu anhu was accidentally harming people. He's a big guy. He's about between 6 to 7 feet tall. So the Prophet told him, Ya Umar, innaka rajulun qawi. Look what he said. You're a strong man. He wants to give him an opinion. He's not going to say, well, Umar's going to think ill about me. I'm jealous about how big his muscles are. A'udhu billah. Some people are like that. But look how the Prophet began. What did the Prophet say? You're a strong man. How do you think Umar felt after that? Jazakallah khair. Now question, who is stronger, Umar radiallahu anhu or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Who's strong? Who thinks the Prophet is stronger? Who thinks Umar radiallahu anhu, Umar? Between the ulama, there's a difference right here, mashallah. There's no doubt Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam can knock Umar radiallahu anhu any second. The Prophet is the strongest man in the whole Medina, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when Umar is having that testimonial, it's very powerful to him. Isn't that right? You appreciate now the hadith? For example, I was traveling one time, a brother from Dubai saw me. He's like, brother, I saw your YouTube video on the daily reminder. Takbir, okay? He's like, jazakallah khair, it was great. It felt good, alhamdulillah. May Allah accept from all of us. Amir Rabbil Alameen, may Allah accept your attendance and accept our speech. But now when I go one time to Chicago, an Ustad Luman Ali Khan walks by and he says, come here, come here. I'm like, yes. He's like, I love your work. It's different. So now when the Prophet said that, he beautified the atmosphere. Whether you're an Ustad Nu'man fan or not, and let's have respect to all people, remember that. So now the Umar is ready to accept any advice. He says, إِنَّكَ رَجْلٌ قَوِيٌّ, you're a strong man. And if you wish to kiss the black stone and you see there's a lot of a crowd, you might accidentally harm the people. Therefore, stand away, face the black stone, and then mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, that's what, he did not worry about the judgment of Umar, like, why you're jealous, I'm tall, I'm strong. Many people do not give nasiha because of that. Isn't that right? Let's be realistic. Many people are like that. For example, someone would tell another sister about her clothing. For example, you know, I see your neck, just make sure your hijab covers it. It happens, isn't that right? Then the other one's like, why, you're jealous because my hijab color is better than yours? Right? They're like, you know what? Forget your judgment. Forget nasiha. I'm going to drop it completely. No, don't be like that. Don't be like that. Then other people, they move. Let's go to another category. People's looks. You care about your looks? Generally, you should care about your looks in a way. Worrying about people's judgment? Yes, I will worry about people's judgment in a way. But as long as it does not overcome Allah's judgment, it's not under the cost of overlooking Allah's judgment. Is it clear? This is the foundation. Let me give you a hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever seeks to please the people under the cost of displeasing Allah, what will happen? Two things. Number one, Allah will be displeased by you, and that's enough of a disaster. But then the Prophet adds to that, and he says, Allah will be displeased by you. In addition, the people you try to please will be displeased by you. A very classical example, I'm not sure how it is in Malaysia, but weddings. Is it customary that some sisters will take off their hijab on the wedding day? Is that custom here? Sometimes it happens. And sometimes they keep their hijab on, but they bring a belly dancer, or they bring alcohol, or they do something which Allah and the Prophet is not pleased with. And they asked him, wallahi, many couples, in their heart, they genuinely do not want this to happen. But just to avoid people's judgment, oh, you're boring, this and that, so they bring it just to accommodate the people. But guess what happens? They're the ones who, after the wedding, they diss, and they disrespect, and they criticize every good thing that you've done. Even the things you sought to please them with it. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. Amin Rabbil Alameen. Isn't that right? The same people. Now continue the hadith. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He said, and those who seek to please Allah, and the only option is under the cost of displeasing the people. What will happen? Two things. Allah will be pleased by you, and that's enough of a benefit. And that's the ultimate reward you can ever reach in your existence. Remember that. What's the ultimate reward? If someone asks you, what's the ultimate reward? Is the fact that radiyallahu anki. It's for Allah to be pleased by you. May Allah be pleased by all of us. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. And then after that, then the Prophet says, then the people will be pleased by you. You see how beautiful that is? You appreciate that. So in terms of your looks, some people, they change their looks in a way that they go beyond the limits of the deen. Isn't that right? You guys agree or not? They go beyond the limits of the deen, whether the tightness of their clothing, whether it was the transparent clothing, whatever clothing that Allah and the Prophet is not pleased with. You should do your best to please Allah, and by Allah, modest men and women will attract, bi-idhnillah, modest men and women. So for you who says, I want someone who's modest, then you should be modest. You want a sister who has no previous relationships. For example, may Allah forgive us all. Then you yourself should not have a relationship right now. I want a brother who is very respectful to his parents. Then you be respectful to your parents. It's just the equation. Something to truly appreciate. And since we're talking about beauty and looking good, I want to give you right now in 1 minute a halal makeup tutorial. What do you think? You know there's all over YouTube makeup tutorials? I'll give you a halal makeup tutorial. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ مْرِئًا, may Allah beautify the face of. Now the dua was made by who? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's it, it's done. So all what you have to do is take action. The dua is done. Now the Prophet says, may Allah beautify the face of the person who. Now every one of you will make sure, inshallah, you do that who? To look good, inshallah, right? مَنْ سَمِعَ مِنَّ حَدِيثًا فَبَلَّغَهُ. The one who heard a hadith or a wise statement or from the Prophet and from the Quran, and you conveyed it. So those who give da'wah, Allah beautifies their faces. Allahu Akbar. And as you can see, mashallah, tabarakallah. And that's a joke. No. Just a joke. It's coincidence. No, I'm just kidding. No. May Allah make us sincere in our work that we do. Say ameen. But wallahi, when you do that, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you see old people, but you cannot help but say how good looking they are. I'm pretty sure you will agree with me. You see old people, وَلَا نُزَكِّعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدٍ. We cannot praise on Allah's behalf, but we only see signs. We cannot fully judge, remember that. We cannot fully judge like that. And whenever we're talking about this, please think about yourself as well. You yourself should not judge others. We're talking about the other side, correct? We're talking about them and those who backbite. What about you? Don't do that. The moment you judge someone's intention, look at this. The moment you judge someone's intention is the moment you verbalized you have a corrupted intention. Is it clear? Because no one knows the intentions besides Allah. So you have no right to judge someone being arrogant. You have no right. Why? Because arrogance is in the heart. You have no right, for example, to say Brother Majid is insincere. You have no right because you have no clue, because it's in the heart. You have no idea, I might be the most sincere person here. I might be the opposite. I might be a munafiq. Yes, you never know. Allahu a'lam. But only Allah knows. It was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who was gifted the ability to know the munafiq from not munafiq. May Allah protect us and protect us from nifaq. Say ameen. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. May Allah make us die upon la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Something to truly appreciate. Moving on. Doing an aspect, and I hope you truly appreciate this, which is false testimony. You know what's false testimony? It's a very pressure that a lot of people would judge you accordingly. When you are requested to testify upon something that is false. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time he was sitting. He says, أَلَا أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِأَكْبَرِ الْكَبَائِرِ. Shall I not tell you of the greatest? Pay attention to the words. Shall I not tell you of the greatest of the greatest of sins? Now that's exponential, correct? He says, الشِّرْكُ بِاللَّهِ, which is association with Allah. Number two, وَعُقُوق الْوَالِدَيْنِ, being disrespectful to your parents, disobedient, not loving, etc. The whole equation, if you wish to say. And number three, then he sat down. Then he said, وَشَهَادَةُ الزُّورِ, وَشَهَادَةُ الزُّورِ, وَشَهَادَةُ الزُّورِ. What does that mean? False testimony. It happened to me one time that when I was at university, a brother parked in the handicap parking spot, and he was not handicapped. So what happened is that he had the ticket that he's that car is owned by a handicapped person or is driven by, but that was for his mother. So when he left down the car, there's a musalla on campus. So he went not to pray, he went to class. But then when he got the ticket for $350, should I mention the currency in ringgits? Times about four, about 1,200 ringgits or 1,300 roughly speaking. He was very frustrated, so he went and spoke to the government that gave the issued that ticket. So he told them, you know, I just went to drop my mother at the prayer area, and you saw me, I'm not sure what happened. So they said, give us one person, only one person that will testify that your mother was in the prayer area, then we will waive the fee for you. So the brother calls me up. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Majid. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. He's like, you know, just a quick, easy one for you, akhi. Just, you know, I got a ticket, told me the whole story. All what I want you to do is just come write down that you saw my mother in the musalla, in the prayer area, and then I just dropped her. That's it, very simple. I'll not tell you what happened, but I want you guys to tell me what was the correct thing to do. What do you guys think? What's the correct thing to do or say? Bismillah, go for it. Okay, first, do you agree it's difficult? Some people are like, no, be a strong believer, it's not difficult. Okay, khalas, I'm weak, ya akhi. Okay? Maybe hesitate here and there. What do you guys think would be the correct response? What would you guys do? Go for it. Any suggestions? You guys are very shy. Okay, go ahead. Go ahead. You will pay it for him? Allah, can we be friends, by the way, after the conversation? Yeah, and I can give you my number, inshallah, we'll discuss, inshallah. Is it all pain? Wallahi, that's a beautiful way. Don't you guys agree? And I believe if you're able to do that, just opinion, this is subjective. This is not like haram halal, it's subjective. If you're able to do that, then perhaps that's the best way to go around it. He's like, akhi, you know what? I will pay the 350 for you, but please just realize that this aspect of testifying and so is serious in the deen, and may Allah bless you and protect you. Here's the 350. Man, amazing, right? So something to truly appreciate. One time I was working in a restaurant for five years. I was like, one time I was working in a restaurant. I was working there for 5 years. May Allah protect us. There's nothing wrong with it, by the way. There's nothing, you know, flipping sandwiches, you know, doing gyros or gyros, shawarma, all that good stuff. Anyways, so while I was doing it, one of my friends comes from school. I did it during high school, university. And then he walks in, he's like, Brother Majid, salamu alaikum. Now there's a hookup, right? And he's like, extra chicken. Now, here the judgment kicks in. If you don't put extra chicken, the whole community of that gang of your friends will tell you, stingy, don't ever go to that restaurant, ruin their reputation, go to Google, give me one star, right? Okay, I never go to the stingy place, they hardly put any chicken. But now what do you do? It's very severe. It's like, more chicken. So like, akhi, I got you, brother, no problem, I'll put more chicken for you. Right, there's a way to go about it. Wallahi, this is real life scenarios about people's judgment. You face it on a daily basis. Right now, you actually may be facing as you walk out. Or right now, you might be facing it, you know when? When the camera is on you. Like, then I speaking like, yeah. Right, when the camera is on you, like, like, I want to marry this guy, it's very sincere, sir. The camera is right on you. This is a judgment, really, it's very pressure. May Allah make us sincere in our actions of worship. Ameer Rabbil Alameen, say Ameen. Ameer Rabbil Alameen, it's truly to appreciate. Type, to conclude in the last 11 minutes and 24 seconds that we have. How can we help ourselves to focus on Allah's judgment, focus on pleasing Allah over the people? Two ways. To realize the consequences of not doing so in this life and afterlife. In this life, when it comes to acts of worship, there's a term that is used, which is called riya. You heard that before? It's very critical. Riya, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, it can be called a shirk, al-khafi, the hidden shirk association. It's called a shirk al-asghar, the minor association. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw a group of sahaba discussing Masih al-Dajjal, the Antichrist. May Allah protect you from him. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. Then the Prophet says, shall I not tell you of something more scary or scarier than the Antichrist? What is it, Rasulullah? He said, riya. It is the aspect where a person would do an act of worship. Then the man will pass in front of you. فَيُجَمِّلْ, then that person will beautify their prayers just for that other person's sight to look at while they're praying and ruins it completely. May Allah protect us. Say Ameen. Very serious. So when you know the consequences of it, it minimizes. Many people have that question. So example, the Prophet ﷺ says the consequence of riya, or showing off, or seeking people's praise, worrying about people's judgment, and caring less about Allah's judgment, even under the cost of displeasing Allah, the Prophet said, memorize the hadith, مَنْ سَمَّعَ سَمَّعَ اللَّهُ بِهِ مَنْ سَمَّعَ سَمَّعَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. There's a continuation if you wish to memorize the other one. وَمَنْ رَاءَ رَاءَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. Whoever seeks to be praised on the tongues of people, Allah will make the person mentioned by the people, but opposite of what they want. You pay attention? Opposite of what they want. May Allah protect us. You will see a group of a person always wants praise, always wants praise. People judgments are, okay, you guys pleased by me, that's good, under the cost of displeasing Allah. These same people will say, this guy's a loser, this guy is this and that, when you were trying to please them. You have an example. Forgive me if I'm mentioning that, just something to mention about someone who's dead. You guys know Elvis Presley? Okay, astaghfirullah, yeah, we know him, astaghfirullah. What kind of crowd is this, right? So Elvis Presley, may Allah protect us. And by the way, when I mention, see, you know what, this is a good example right here. Some people will judge, now I watch movies, I watch Elvis, and I do his dance and all that stuff. And how come you know about this? Astaghfirullah, ittaqillah. You're in such a noble position right here, speaking to 15, 2,000 people, and then now you're mentioning this, judging. Does it happen? It happened. I was giving a Friday khutbah, and I mentioned something about Disneyland. You guys know Disneyland? Okay, this is like Jannah for the non-Muslims, kind of Jannah, okay? But it's just strange, will I? Like, oh my God, Mickey Mouse, he's a mouse. Like, I don't know, it's like, oh my God, Mickey Mouse. Anyways, so I mentioned that in the khutbah, and then one guy says, brother, jazakallah khair for the khutbah, but there's no need to mention a kafir's name in such noble position. What do you guys think? What do you guys think? Is correct? Can you respond? What do you think? Is that he's right? I'm wrong? You'll never say that in front of me, right? Brother, you are right, akhi. Huh? Didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention Fir'aun and Abu Lahab in the Quran? So as long as you're mentioning it with a benefit, there's nothing wrong with that, bi-idhnillah. Going back to Elvis. So Elvis Presley, for those that know a little bit about him, eventually he was exposed to be a womanizer. He was a man who was the one who is accused of promoting the adult industry. He was that man. He was the man who eventually, before he died, they used to say, Elvis the pelvis. This is the pelvis that you're all about. SubhanAllah, and he used to hate that term. And look how that person would be exposed. Man sama'a sama'a Allah bih. This is proven historically and religiously, both. And how did he die? He died in his mansion, quote unquote, in his bathroom, while he was taking drugs. He threw up. And he fell where he threw up and he died on the spot. May Allah give us all a beautiful ending to our lives. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. This is the seriousness of seeking people's judgment over Allah. Or just even people, and obviously was not believing in Allah to begin with. May Allah protect us, Ameen Rabbil Alameen. This is how serious it is. And the other thing you have to realize really well, you will never be able to please everybody. It is impossible. If there's one person who would have been able to do so, who would it be? If there's one person who was able to do so, who would it be? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and even him, they criticized him. Isn't that right? Sahir, majnoon, kahin, possessed, magician, an idiot, insane, retard, that's what they called him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Mudhammam, which means the most dispraised, when his name was Muhammad, the most praised. And that's the Prophet. Then what makes you think you are able to do it? And you would sell your deen for people's judgment. May Allah protect us. Wallahi, if there's one entity that is worth, not worth, that one entity that could have had people be pleased with, or should have, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one entity all of us should have been pleased with Allah. But even Allah, what did they say about him? Inna Allah faqir. Allah says in the Quran, they said about Allah, he's stingy, he's poor. They said, yadullahi maghloola. Allah's hand, Allah's very stingy. Then Allah says, ghullat aydihim wa lu'inu bima qalu, bal yadahu mabsutatan. Rather, Allah says, may Allah curse them. For Allah is generous. But they said that about Allah. Well, you think you'll be saved from the tongues of the people? Don't ever let the people's judgment upon you be an obstacle to move forward in your life. Wallahi, I'm a nobody. And I have to make it very clear. I'm willing to spend half a minute on this, or even a minute, or even the entire lecture. You should not be confused when you see a lineup of speakers that we're all at the same level of knowledge. There's no way I'm anywhere near Dr. Bilal Phillips. Nowhere near. So you have to, when you sit in such gathering, you have to know who's talking to you at what level. That's why I don't go to beyond my limit of the topic. And you have to appreciate that. Whatever people judge, Dr. Bilal, oh, this isn't that, Brother Majid, this isn't that. No, don't ever say that. Something to truly appreciate. But he moves on. If Dr. Bilal were to be worried about people's judgment, he probably would have not came to this conference. You guys agree? I'm going to speak by this white boy, Majid, right? But he came and spoke. And you know what's amazing? Speaking before. And the conference schedule, that's something amazing. How humble a man would have been. And Allah knows best their intentions. We don't praise on Allah's behalf, but we see signs of humbleness. May Allah protect them. Say ameen. And protect all the speakers. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. But that's something to truly appreciate. Move on in life. Move on in life. A poster came about this conference. And then I believe, if I'm not mistaken, someone said, look at these dogs of hellfire. May Allah protect us. Severe, harsh comment. What kind of statement is that? But if I'm worried about his judgment, I'm going to, you know, tell the organizers, I'm going to have to leave. Sorry, people are going to think, I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm not qualified, so I'm going to have to leave. No, you got to move on. You got to keep moving on. You got a divorce in your life, and people are going to keep judging you. Oh, you must have been a bad lady, and you want to go commit suicide. A'udhu billah. Be strong, sister. Be strong, brother. Move on in life. Don't let people's judgment be an obstacle. Are you guys ready for that? Say inshallah. Really, don't allow that to ever happen. Not even. And the worst people that you can be harmed by is yourself. When you're very extreme upon yourself, yes, judge yourself. Umar radiallahu anhu says, حاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا. Hold yourself accountable before you are held accountable. But don't go into extremes. Don't go into extremes that the moment you do one thing, you want to go commit suicide. I'm a munafiq, I want to kill myself. No, relax. We all do sins. And sometimes what we need is knowledge. May Allah make us strong. Say ameen. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. In the afterlife, in the last 3 minutes that I have, these are some consequences in the dunya. In the akhirah, when you seek people's judgment, one of the most devastating things is that you will not find a reward of that action. Very devastating. Imagine you work really hard to please the people. Are you guys happy with me? Yes, we are. You go yawm al-qiyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِذْهَبُوا إِلَى الَّذِينَ كُنْتُمْ تُرَاؤُونَ فِي الدُّنْيَا. Go to the people that you sought their pleasure. Go to them. Then Allah mocks them and says, فَانْظُرُوا هَلْ تَجِدُونَ عِنْدَهُمْ جَزَاءً وَخَيْرًا. Go to them. See, do they have some hasanat for you, reward? They will grant you their own jannah. They have a small two-apartment jannah for them. Maybe they will... mocking them. Wallahi, how devastating is it for Allah to say that to one of us? May Allah make us sincere. Say ameen. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives us the example of the ones. Question for you guys, but make it quick. Don't be shy. Respond. Even if it's wrong, no problem. Don't worry about people's judgment. Give the response. How you know, they say two people will never learn, the ulama said. The one who is extremely shy and the one who is arrogant. So try not to be both. So if you have an answer, you want to give it a shot, give it a shot. Because when you answer, and let's say you get it wrong, or you get it right, you'll be the most that actually will remember the answer. Correct? Tayyib, who are the first three people to be thrown in hellfire? Raise your hand. No hands? Go ahead. Shuhada, martyrs. Akhi, maybe there's a mistake. What do you mean shuhada? Shuhada, first people to be thrown in Jahannam? They give up their lives. Continue. Ulama, astaghfirullah al-azim. Okay, let me rephrase that. The first three will enter Jahannam, not Jannah. Okay, maybe the mistake. He says, shuhada, ulama. If I'm a teacher, I'm going to go, may Allah protect us. What's the third one? Gives charity? La, you missed up completely, subhanAllah, right? And the ones who sponsored this event, subhanAllah, like, why you say that? May Allah protect us, say ameen. Correct? This authentic hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أول من تسعر بهم النار. The first three to be thrown in Jahannam. A man who, quote unquote, fought for the sake of Allah, then was killed. And Allah speaks to that, shaheed. And Allah said, what have you done with what I've given to you? He said, ya Allah, I fought for your sake. I used my courage that you blessed me with. I used my strength for your sake. Allah said, كذبت, you're a liar. You did this and you've done this just so people can say, shuja', what a courageous man. That's why you did it. وَقَدْ قِيلَ, and you got what you want. You got it. But today you pay the penalty. Then Allah tells the angels, grab this man and throw him in hellfire. May Allah protect us. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. That's why we cannot confirm a person is a shaheed. We say he's inshallah a shaheed. And then that alim comes in. What did you do with what I've given you? I have spread your knowledge. I've given talks. I traveled around the world. I made them smile. I made them laugh. I made them cry. I got them closer to you. Then Allah says, you're a liar. You did this just so you can be more praised by the people. يقال له عالم. What a qari. What a person. What a reciter. What a speaker. What a preacher. وَقَدْ قِيلٍ. You got it. You got the followers on Twitter. You got the likes on Facebook. And Allah will customize according to your case. But now you pay the penalty for it. May Allah protect us. So the point being, brothers and sisters, do your best, challenge yourself to not worry much about the people, yet seek to unite the people as long as not under the cost of displeasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakum Allahu khairan. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Wa jazakum Allahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.